On average, flat roads like this cost around $1 million per lane mile to build. But these winding mountain roads can cost up to 10 times that. That's because
you can't just excavate rock, you have to blast.
And that's really expensive, which is one of the reasons why brand new mountain roads aren't built very often.
We only want to design and build them once.
We asked a structural engineer with over 25 years of experience to explain how these steep inclines and sharp turns are designed to keep drivers safe in the mountains.
There's a lot of different kinds of mountain roads. I think as a tourist, a lot of people think of the very narrow, windy mountain roads. But additionally, you have interstates going through the mountains, and those are mountain roads.
Heffron says that digging a tunnel through the mountain is usually expensive and highly risky. So managing that vertical climb is key.
That's what we call the grade of the road. And we talk about it in percentages. So for every 100 feet you travel, you want to try to keep it to 5 feet max. In the mountains, a lot of times you're going to exceed that. You may go 6.5 or even 10%.
Mountain roads also have to maneuver around a lot of natural obstacles, affecting its path or horizontal alignment.
When you get to a mountain setting, the edges of your roadway are defined by nature. One of the things you're trying to define is how wide will the roadway be? We may decide to narrow the lane widths up to 11 feet so that we can stay out of the creek or not have to blast into the adjacent rock. And these things are pretty imperceptible to the driver. You don't really get a tape measure out every 100 feet, but as a designer, you do.
When the terrain gets too steep, switchbacks become necessary. Heffron says these tighter turns also help reduce how much the mountainside is affected by the road.
On a more rural, low-volume road, you may have more switchbacks and tighter turns. It's a nice 200-foot radius to make that switchback and get around that curve. Whereas on an interstate, instead of 200, you have 1,000, about five times that.
When the road curves, there's usually an added design feature called super elevation, which is where the roadway is tilted to make it easier to navigate a curve.
So as you're entering a curve as a driver, and you're turning, the roadway isn't flat, but it's going to super elevate. It's going to raise on the high side, kind of like you see at a speed track. The centripetal force will keep you on the roadway.
Super elevation is especially important in the mountains, where roads get icy quickly.
If the roadway were flat, especially if this roadway is icy, you could veer off the roadway.
Heffron says super elevation starts at around 2% and gets steeper as the speed of the roadway increases.
Sometimes in the mountains, you'll go 5, 6%, maybe 8, but you're trying to keep it not too steep because as this roadway ices over, and if there's a lot of traffic during a snowstorm, and the cars go slower, and they might have the propensity to slide horizontally, which is not safe.
Rockfall makes mountain road design even more challenging.
A lot of rock stability and rockfall is controlled specifically by the geometry.
This is Howard Hume. His job is to identify these, the breaks in the rock face, also called rock joints, and
how they interact with the face angle, whether they project out of the slope, in which case they're a problem, in which case you've got to stop them. You can see horizontal jointing in the face.
Hume says the stability of rock faces varies widely, but in general, if rock joints are horizontal or at a very low angle with respect to the road,
it's not a problem. If it's dipping steeply and you're standing underneath it, that's definitely a problem.
Hume and his team use a drone to take hundreds or even thousands of photos of the rock face.
You got the area over there.
To create models like this and this, which he uses to simulate different types of rock fall. This helps him decide the most stable angle to cut the rock face.
When I say cut eventually in rock like this, you've got to blast it.
And then there's the surrounding water that engineers have to deal with.
As the water is coming down from the mountainsides, it's moving fast.
To manage this, Heffron says there are various drainage systems like this or this.
A lot of times you'll see kind of a pipe sticking out from the side of the road. And it comes out here and drains away from the roadway into the creek.
A lot of mountain roads started out as wagon trails, which generally followed streams and creeks. This was often the easiest and cheapest way to get through the terrain. Over time, those wagon trails were adjusted and widened to fit automobiles. But being so close to water means designers have to add elements like
riprap. Riprap is just big rocks placed in a way such that it helps stabilize and maintain the side of the creek which is supporting the side of your roadway.
Water mitigation also helps prevent soil erosion, which can be extremely dangerous for mountain roads. In 2020, a wildfire burned over 30,000 acres in Colorado's Glenwood Canyon. And because there was no vegetation, the storms that hit the area the following year caused repeated flooding and debris flow that shut down a section of the interstate for about 2 weeks.
I-70 is closed once again in Glenwood Canyon, this time for 5 mudslides covering hundreds of feet of highway.
Even though mountain roads often have more variables than flat roads, Heffron says consistency is still the goal.
We're going to have some steep turns, but if all of a sudden in our design we interject along the roadway a very steep turn, then your safety overall goes down because of the lack of consistency. As people are traveling a mountain road, you don't want them to think about the infrastructure. You want them to think about the beauty of the nature that they're traveling through. You're getting the full experience. It's snowing.